Cary Elwes. Just like right around the corner. You're all wired. He's all wired. He's all
I'm very wired. I've had lots of coffee. I'm ready to go.
He's ready to go.
I've had official Seattle Starbucks coffee. And now I know that some Seattle folks are not happy about the idea of me drinking Starbucks. I've heard that already. But I'm a creature of habit. So just, you'll have to let me slide on that. Hey, Paul? Go.
So you're really enjoying yourself, just to warm up for a moment. You're having a great time on this tour.
I love it.
It started for a bit, and then you took some time off to
yes.
do what?
I went off to make a movie in, where was I? New Orleans, with Mira Savino, and it's a thriller called Indiscretion, and I play her husband in the movie, and I just wrapped 2 days ago.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yes.
So how long, that was like a 3 weeks.
That was a three-week yeah,
shoot or something like
shoot,
that.
Yeah.
Because,
yeah.
you know, I know all the movie films.
We can't hear you back
Sorry.
There.
Here we go.
Hello.
Can you hear us now?
Can you hear us back in?
Is
How
that
far
better?
Are They're way back in children's. It's crazy. They're back in the Dr. Seuss section.
Can you guys hear us now?
Yeah.
All right, good. Okay. Well, welcome to Seattle. We're obviously thrilled to have you, and... This is a quote machine over here. We can just call out your favorite quotes. You're all, you know, it's just great that you're here. So we're just going to ask 5 questions, and then if you're up for it, we'll do some Q&A-ish kind of stuff.
Absolutely.
Okay.
As you wish.
You know, sorry, but what can I say? I'll just melt here or wet myself or something. Okay. So, the book feels like a love letter to Andre the Giant.
Yes, very much so.
So everyone in the movie has amazing stories to tell about him. And there are so many legends about Andre that have been told over the years. But your mention of meeting him for the first time and that night in the hotel.
Yes.
Will be talked about for a long time to come. What can you tell us about some of those adventures you had with Andre?
Well, I think the one that comes to mind probably is the first scene working together. The first time I got to work with Andre, the first scene that we shot together was the scene where we're on the parapet of Florin Castle, where Westley is mostly dead. And I'm there with Mandy as Montoya and the wonderful Andre the Giant. And by the way, I should point out, Andre was the sweetest guy, and I miss him to this day. We all do. He was really a gentle giant. He would give you the shirt off his back. It'd be enough for 5 people. He'd still give it. Anyway, he was just the most beloved guy on the set, and we all just adored him. Anyway, so the first day was that scene where I come to. Now, the dialogue, and some of you can correct me if I'm wrong.
And they will.
It's 27 years, so I'm sure you guys know it better than I do. Anyway, so I think the first line was Fezzik, where he says to Montoya, and now I do my Andre impersonation, I wonder how long before the pill takes effect. And I think Montoya says, your guess is as good as mine. And then I come to, and I say, I'll fight you both together, or beat you both apart. Is that right? Yeah, thank you. And then Andre has the next line. Fezzik has the next line where he goes, I guess not very long. Like that, right?
Yes.
He didn't get to the word long before he emitted what has to be the most ginormous fart. I kid you not. I mean, look, we've all experienced giant farts and accused people of letting out a giant fart. This was a giant's fart. Somebody timed it. It was 15 seconds. It was just monumental, like ear splitting. And I remember we all grabbed the set. We all thought it was like an earthquake. We all grabbed the set, shaking. And I looked over at Andre, and he had this beautiful smile on his face, like blissful relief. And he had steam coming out of the top of his head. I don't know why, to this day. It was the most bizarre combination, the fart, the steam. I couldn't look at him. So I looked over at the sound man, who had his headphones on. And it went on for 15 seconds. Finally, when he was done, there was a stunned silence. You know, not like in America where after someone farts, they're like, dude, you. In England, it's all very polite, like that. And Rob Reiner, the director, broke the silence by saying, hey, Andre, you okay? Swear to God. And Andre, without missing a beat, said, I am now, boss. And that was my first day. I mean, he ruined us. We were done. It was just hilarious, yeah.
And Andre the Giant part.
Yeah.
I mean, people probably died.
Some eardrums were probably split.
I'm just jumping around here, but I wanted to ask too, was it hard to remember all these stories from 27? You recall them really beautifully, so.
Did you
keep a journal, or what did you do?
I didn't, actually. I don't keep a journal or a diary while I'm working, because I'm so focused on the role I'm playing, I usually don't have a lot of time to sit around and, I mean, I know I've met actors who do that, and I admire them for doing that, but I really, when I'm working, I'm really focused on the part and the role and the lines I have to learn, the scene, and so on. And, you know, looking back now, I wish I had, because when I got the call from Simon & Schuster to do the book, they said, so I guess your memory's pretty good then. And I completely lied, and I went, yeah, it's great. And after I hung up with them, I turned to my wife and went, I don't know what I'm going to do. I think I remember maybe 5 or 6 stories or something. And I called Norman Lear, who you interviewed, I guess, a few weeks ago. The wonderful Norman Lear. For those of you who don't know who Norman Lear is, Norman Lear is the responsible for the great shows All in the Family, in which Rob Reiner starred as Meathead. Archie Bunker's plays, The Jeffersons, Maud, and so on. And he was the executive producer of The Princess Bride. And he took me to lunch, and I shared with him my concern. I said, look, I told Simon & Schuster I'm going to write this book, and I can only remember maybe 5 or 6 stories. And he said, don't worry, Cary, I'm going to send you all the call sheets from the film, and that'll help you. Now, the call sheets are the work orders that you get, that the crew and the cast get, that tell you, you know, what time you have to be on the set, what scenes you're shooting, the location, and so on. And he said, when you see these, it'll help to trigger your memory, and it'll, you know, that'll be that. And of course, a week later, he sent me this beautiful bound edition of all these call sheets. I hadn't seen these in 27 years. And I opened up the first page, the first day's shooting. And it was amazing. It was like 27 years just melted away, and I was right back on the set like it was yesterday. It was incredible. So that's how I started remembering. It all felt, he was absolutely right. But he's a genius, so he knew exactly what he was talking about. Yeah.
Yeah, he's a lovely man.
Yeah, lovely.
We're lucky to work with him.
Yeah.
We have to talk about Billy Crystal.
Okay.
I'm sorry. And we have to talk about his improvising.
Yes.
And I'd love to hear you describe trying not to laugh, because I still, to this day, I mean, everybody's got their Princess Bride quotes, or like 80 of them. But mine is, you know, have fun storming the castle. But anyway, talk about a little bit about his just trying to keep a straight face, I guess is
sure.
The best way to put it.
Okay, so Billy and Carol Kane, who played his wife Valerie, arrived about the first week of October.
May I ask where you were shooting, where that all was?
That was all, we were in Shepperton, back on Shepperton. So we started the movie at Shepperton with the fire swamp, because Rob wanted to get all the fire swamp stuff out of the way. And then we went on location to Derbyshire, to Haddon Hall, which double for Florin Castle. And then we came back and shot all the other sequences, including Miracle Max's Hovel and the Cliffs of Insanity. And so those, all those sets were still being built while we were on location. So Billy and Carol Kane arrived in the first week of October, and they had to go through 8 hours of makeup, you know, to create these characters. So they had a long time in the chair. And Billy brought his makeup artist that he worked with on SNL, a guy called Peter Montagna, and he told Peter he wanted Max to be a cross between his grandmother and Casey Stengel, the Yankees manager. For you. And what was great is I got to watch him transform into Max. And when Peter Montagna put the last touches of Max on him, there's these huge eyebrows and his cataract contact lenses and this ginormous wig, he became Max and he stayed in character. He even went to the commissary at Shepperton and ordered food as Miracle Max. He was like in line and he said to the lady behind the counter, he goes, the shepherd's pie, is it spicy? And she said to him, no, not really. And he goes, you don't know my colon. That kind of thing. And that's, he stayed in character the whole time. So after lunch is when we shot the scene, and I thought I had an easy day because, you know, in the scene, if you remember, I'm just lying on the slab and I have like two words. I say true love when he presses my
so
chest.
True.
Yeah. Very good. Very good. Very good. Do you want to try it again?
True love.
Why do you think they asked me to be here?
That's
come
wonderful.
On.
Wonderful.
Yeah, I haven't even begun to tell you. You have no idea.
That's great.
No, and same here, I mean, we could all do it.
That's
so
awesome. So yeah, so I thought I had a pretty easy day, right? I had two lines, I mean, how long it took me to learn that, right? And so I'm lying on the slab, and they're preparing to do the scene, and the director, Rob Reiner, comes up, and he goes, hey, Gary, we look through the monitor and we can see your chest moving when you're breathing, so you're gonna have to hold your breath during the scene.
Oh.
And I said, well, for how long? He goes, don't worry, we're not gonna kill you. And then he walked over to Billy Crystal and whispered in his ear, and I didn't know what he whispered until I found out later on. He said to him, just go for it. Not that Billy needed much encouraging. But once Rob yelled action, Billy launched into literally 3 hours of medieval Yiddish stand-up. And the first person to laugh was Rob, because he has this very boisterous laugh. I describe it as a laugh that could be heard in Detroit. And the sound guy came over and said, and by the way, in England, all the crew call the director governor. Sound guy came up and went, oh, I'm sorry, governor, you're going to have to leave the set because you're ruining it. The laugh. I mean, you know. So the director, Rob Reiner, actually was banished from his own movie. And they set up a monitor for him outside on the hallway outside the soundstage. And of course, there I am now having to be totally still and not even moving my chest, holding my breath. And there's Billy, like, hanging over me, doing jokes that I can't repeat because, you know, there are cool and young kids here that are always very blue. And anyway, and I lost it. I mean, there was no way I could. There's no way. And so I was the next guy that the sound people had me replace with my rubber dummy. Some people assert acted better than I did. I won't argue with that. But yes, if you look in the wide shots of the scene, that's my rubber mannequin replaced. I was replaced by that.
Because of the laughter.
Because of the laughter. And then in the tight shots, it's just me without Billy. Just lying. That was the only way it could be done. And Mandy Patinkin claims that he actually bruised a rib for trying to hold his laughter. I didn't even know that you could do that. But Mandy says that's the only injury he got on the movie. Was bruising a rib trying to hold his laughter. So yeah, it was pretty eventful. It took a long, long time to shoot that scene.
That very short scene.
Yeah, it was supposed to be a very short scene. Ended up being 3 days. Crazy.
They're running around the kitchen.
Crazy.
Okay. You mentioned your love for all of William Goldman's work throughout the book.
Yeah.
What was it like getting to have William Goldman on set?
Oh,
now, this
gosh.
Is the man who did
All the President's Men, Butch Cassidy and Sundance Kid, Marathon Man. I mean, he's a legend. I mean,
Misery.
Thank you.
Very good. Oh,
yes,
God.
Misery. Yeah. So this was actually the first collaboration between Rob and Bill, which obviously went on to become a very successful one. And now this book, when he wrote The Princess Bride in 73, he conceived of the idea by asking his daughters on a trip to California. He asked them both, you know, what do you guys want me to write about? And one daughter said princesses and the other said brides. So it was a very sweet beginning right there, right? And so Bill shared with us at the very beginning of the movie, this whole story is very personal to me. So if I seem nervous, that's why. It's my favorite book. It's my favorite screenplay, and hopefully it'll be my favorite movie. So there was no pressure there, right? So he wanted to be there from the very start, and he usually doesn't like hanging around on sets. He doesn't really care to be around. He said once a writer's finished doing the rewrites and whatever, then he doesn't want to be around anymore. Anyway, he was there for the very first shooting, first day of shooting. So Rob wanted to start the very first day with the flame spurt in the fire swamp where Robin catches on fire, where Buttercup's on. And I said to him, I said, you really want to start with that? He goes, yeah, we're going to start light and then work our way to the quicksand and then the that. And I said, oh, okay, sure, you know. And so the first day, we had the special effects department and the stunt people take us for a walk around the set and show us what's known as like a what do they call it? They call it a safety meeting. Yes, a safety meeting, where they showed us exactly where the flame spurts were going to come out of the ground and where not to walk and where to walk and how to be careful. And when they finished doing the safety meeting, they showed us the how it was going to work with our two stunt doubles. And after they showed us with the stunt doubles, it was up to Robin and I to go and do it. And I remember Robin was standing right there and Rob said to her, hey, Robin, listen. If you don't want to do it, don't worry. The doubles can do it. It'll be fine. We can work around. And Robin didn't blink. She was like, no, it's fine. I can do it. No problem. And then Rob looked at me and went, and what about you? And what was I going to say? Like, no. And I was like, sure, no problem. And if you look in the book, you can see the flame. That's the first picture ever taken during the shoot. Is of this 12-foot flame. I think the stunt guy the special effects guy got very excited and pushed way too much gas out of the cylinder, and you have this 12-foot flame. And Bill Goldman had missed the safety meeting. He'd forgotten what we were shooting that first day. Arrived on the set in the middle of this 12-foot flame and screamed in the middle of the take, she's on fire! Robin Wright is on fire! Somebody put her out, my gosh! And Rob went, cut. Turned to Bill Goldman, went, Bill, she's supposed to catch fire. You wrote it in the last 8 drafts. It's in the book. What are you doing? And he was mortified. But he turned to Rob and went, what are you, crazy? You just set fire to Robin Wright on the first day. It's not like we can replace her. And he had a point, you know. But so ended up doing a couple more takes, and we got it in the end. But Bill was mortified. And he wanted to pack his bags and go home that day. But we convinced him to stay because we, you know, we all loved him and still love him, and we wanted to have him around because we just wanted to have him around. So he stuck around for about another week or two, and then he left, yeah.
Didn't one of the rodents of unusual size get thrown in jail and you had to go bail?
You want to hear that story? You
want to hear well, about that? I'm sticking to a very strict script, but...
All right.
I love that story.
All right, you do? Okay. All right, so... We didn't have a lot of money, obviously, for CGI, and there wasn't really CGI back then in 1986, not like today. If the movie was made today, it would probably have a lot of CGI involved with the rodents and the eels and so on. So we actually had little people inside, three little rodent outfits, right? And they were very thick rodent outfits. They were made of latex rubber, and they had lots of fur, and they were very hot. And the soundstage where we were shooting was very warm, enormous lights up. And these poor little guys were in these suits all day long, and they had to be sewn into them. It wasn't like a, you know, Velcro or anything like that. They actually had to be sewn into them in case, you know, because Velcro could come undone, and then we'd have to redo the take. And so these poor guys would never complain, by the way. And there was only one of them who was both an actor and a stuntman. And his name was Danny Blackner. I'll never forget. He was a wonderful guy, Cockney guy. He had earrings. You know how you see today folks who have earrings all the way up and down their ear? This is in 1986. No one had ever, I'd never seen anyone. He was way ahead of his time. He was like, his tattoos, the whole thing. And
it's Seattle tattoos, right?
Yeah. And we came to rehearse this fight sequence that I'm supposed to roll on the ground with him, and he bites my shoulder, and then I take out my sword and I stab him with a fake sword. They give me a sword that's a retractable one, right? And Rob called cut after the first rehearsal and went, it's kind of late, why don't we pick this up tomorrow and we'll shoot it tomorrow. So we cut for the day and we all went home, and then the next morning I came into work and I noticed there was a big huddle around the monitor, the producers and production manager and Andy Scheinman and Rob Reiner, and it looked like a very serious discussion. I walked over to them. I said, "What's going on, guys?" And they said, "We got a problem." I said, "What?" He said, "Danny, we can't find him." I said, "Well, why don't we just use one of the other guys?" "No, we can't. He's a stunt man. He's the only one who could do it. It's a legal thing." I said, "Well, what are we going to do?" And so Rob said, "Well, maybe you can play with the rubber rat for a while." And I'm like, "Really? Seriously?" He goes, "Yeah, we'll make it work." Because that was the last day we had shooting on that soundstage. After that day, we had to move to location, to Derbyshire. So, I mean, for 4 hours, I played with this rubber. And this ludicrous footage somewhere in the trying to make a rubber rat. Just ridiculous. And all the time, Rob is trying to make, he's trying to put in, there's a picture of him trying to direct me with it. It's hilarious. He's like, "You know, if you move the tail a little, and then the arm, and then you open the mouth, it'll look real. It'll look real. You can do it.
One of the rats has gotten in a...
Well, I'll get to it. So anyway. I got you. So anyway, so after 4 hours of this total ridiculous footage, that none of it was usable. None of it, right? Finally, Danny shows up, and we all stop shooting. We run over to him, and Rob goes up to him and says, "Danny, I'm so glad you're here. What happened?" And he goes, "Governor, it's a long story." And Rob went, "We've got all day." "Well, not much, but we want to hear it, you know." So he started to tell us the story how, after we wrapped the night before, he had gone to the bar with a couple of friends, and, you know, they'd been celebrating. And he said, "I won't lie to you, Governor, we had a few, just a few. And then I got in my car, my special modified car." And Rob went, "What's the modified car?" He said, "Oh, you know, a special car, Governor. I need a brick to put on my foot so I can reach the pedal. And I got the gear lever right here. And I was driving out, I was doing, you know, I was driving carefully, Governor. You know, I only had a couple, I promise. And then suddenly I hear a siren, didn't I, Governor?" And he goes, "What do you mean?" He goes, "Yeah, a police car pulls me over. And so I pull over, and the policeman gets out of the car, and he knocks on the window, and I wind down the window, and he says,
do you know why I pulled you over, son? And I says, no. And he says, because you were doing 5 miles an hour. And I says, well, I wasn't speeding. He says, step out of the vehicle, please, son. So I get out of the vehicle, and I hop out, and I've got the brick on one foot, don't I? And he says, have you been drinking, son? And I says, yeah, you know, I had a couple. No, not too much, just a couple. And he says, right, back of the van for you. And he says, no, 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 you can't arrest me, officer. I have to be at work in a couple of hours. I've got to be on the set. I'm making a movie. He says, you're making a movie? What role are you playing? I'm playing a rat. Right, back of the van. Back of the van for you. And he said, he spent the night in jail. He said, I spent the night in jail. And of course, it was before cell phones. He said, I had to spend the night in jail and I had to wait in the next morning to call production and they let me out. And so Danny, thank God, arrived just in time for us to shoot the sequence, just. And that we had maybe 2 takes to get it. And he saved the day. But that's the story of how Danny became the rodent of unusual size to fight
with a record.
With a record. Yeah.
At what moment did you realize that The Princess Bride was becoming larger than life? I mean, I loved seeing this dude, of course.
How great.
I mean, there's children here, there's people as, you know, I'm older than dirt. I mean, we're all here. And we love it, and it never gets old. So when did you realize that the movie had this kind of, you know, lasting... Well,
when the film came out, it didn't do the kind of box office we'd hoped. The studio had a tough time marketing it. They didn't know what to sell. It was a mishmash of genres, as you know. It's a fairy tale, it's a comedy, it's an adult film, a kid's movie, action, and so on. But it's all of those things and more. I think that's part of the appeal of the film, yeah? But studio marketing departments don't like the idea of different genres, especially more than 3. And so they didn't know which angle to pitch. And so they went for the kids' angle because they thought that was the easiest one with the title, The Princess Bride. So they created this lovely poster, which you probably know. It's a sort of Maxfield Parrish type poster, and it has Peter Falk reading to Fred Savage, the grandson on it. And folks mainly stayed away. And so, sadly, the film opened and closed. I think we opened the same weekend as Fatal Attraction, which made a few bucks.
So everyone just brought their kids to that movie.
Exactly. So anyway, it wasn't until about 10 years later that the video market took off. VHS appeared on the scene, and folks started renting it. And how many people here have a VHS copy? There you go. I still meet you. I mean, people still have, you guys still have your copies. It's incredible. And so, you know, people started renting them, buying them, and giving them as gifts to friends and family, and now passing down from generation to generation, right? And that's how the film started to gain an audience. And I'll never forget, I was in a restaurant in Manhattan, and I was ordering a hamburger, and the waitress asked me, she goes, how do you want that cooked? And I said, medium rare. And she just went, as you wish. I said, excuse me. And she went, you know. Like that. And she winked at me and walked away. I'd never had anyone say those 3 words to me before. So that was a weird and wonderful moment, and I realized that, you know, this film that had been mostly dead, mostly dead for about a decade, suddenly came back to life. And now it's this wonderful thing. And thanks to the internet. If we had the internet back then, boy, I think we would have been in good shape.
I just love the way it's evolved and it's been passed down. And
it's the gift that keeps on giving.
It is. Yeah, to you. And I think you're more than happy to have it be part of your legacy.
Are you kidding? I feel blessed. I think I can speak on behalf of everyone involved with the film when I say that we all feel incredibly blessed that you guys have all taken it to your hearts. I mean, it's really a beautiful thing. Really.
I have about 4,000 questions, but it's an infinitely quotable movie.
Yes.
Am I right?
Yes.
Apart from As You Wish, it's the title of the book. what is your favorite quote? And then we should just have people random. Okay. What is your...
My favorite quote is kind of obscure. I'm kind of partial to anybody want a peanut. Obvious that that's a favorite for some of you.
I'm a big Wallace Shawn
yeah,
fan,
yeah.
Especially after the guy that Woody Allen described in, I think it was Annie Hall, as a homunculus.
Yes.
And then he shows up, and he's in your film, and I just adore that scene with the wine and the whole thing.
Now listen, I have it easy, because folks want me to say those three words, and I always comply. But Wally, if he misses an elevator, someone's yelling, inconceivable! If he's late for a plane, anything. So he doesn't get a break. And Billy Crystal says he can never walk into a deli again, because someone will go, you want it lean? Never can order a sandwich again, ever.
That's the best scene for me. I love it, and it's yeah, hilarious. So let's talk, if we could talk about him for a minute. I can't believe about his inconceivable insecurity. Can you tell our audience anything about that?
Sure. Well, okay, so I only have one scene with Wally, as you know, in the movie, which is the Battle of Wits scene, right? And again, I had a pretty easy day. He had all the dialogue. You know, I arrived there, and he's got a knife to Buttercup's neck, and he has all this fabulous dialogue about, you know, Socrates, Aristotle, morons, all of that, right? And you know, for those of you who don't know who Wallace Shawn is, Wally Shawn is one of the smartest people on the planet, for real. I mean, it's the reason why he's perfectly cast. He's an author, and he's a playwright. He's a Fulbright scholar, you know, and he gets paid a lot of money to go and lecture English and American literature at universities around the world, including Oxford and Cambridge. In fact, he was doing a lecture, I think, at Cambridge while we were shooting. And so when I showed up for work, I was obviously blown away. I'd seen him in a film called My Dinner with Andre with his friend Andre Gregory. It was a wonderful film. And I thought, why is Wally Shawn always the smartest guy in the room? Why is he sweating over this little scene that should be nothing for this genius, right? And I couldn't understand why. And it wasn't until we interviewed him for the book that I found out that he said that his agent had told him that he was not the first choice for the role of Vincini, that in fact, Rob and the producers wanted Danny DeVito, which, by the way, if there are any agents here tonight, don't ever tell your client that they're not the first choice. That's not a good thing to do, okay? So Wally was totally insecure about this, and that was why he was sweating that day. Because he was convinced, not only was he convinced that they wanted Danny DeVito, but he was convinced that Danny DeVito was actually going to be flown out and he was going to be replaced by Danny DeVito. That's how insecure he was.
That is inconceivable.
Inconceivable. He even went up to Rob Reiner. He goes, I don't know why you cast me in this role. I'm not even Sicilian. I'm a Jew from New York. But I love what you're doing. It's great when you yell. It's funny. It's good. And to this day, I don't think Wally fully understands how great he is in the part. But, I mean, when you look at it, you can't imagine anybody else. No offense to Danny DeVito, but you really can't imagine anyone else than Wally playing that, right? He's great. So, anyway, he said the ghost of Danny DeVito haunted him throughout the entire
Okay, can you tell us a little more about your kind of love affair with Andre, and how, aside from...
Okay, so after we wrapped the movie, we had two premieres. We had one premiere for the Toronto Film Festival in 1987, and then we had a second premiere in New York. I think it was at the Ziegfeld or somewhere like that. And we had a dinner with Rob and the whole cast, and afterwards, everybody went their separate ways, and Andre turned to me and went, he called everybody boss, which was so cute for a guy who's 7'5". He goes to me and goes, well, go another drink, boss. I thought, you know, what am I going to say? What are the chances I'm going to have to go drinking with Andre in New York? Is where, by the way, he was famous for drinking. He knew all the bars in New York. So we went bar hopping. So the first bar we went to, I think, was called PJ Clark's. Is that right?
Yeah.
PJ? Yeah, PJ.
which, by the way, they've got like a stool that's his stool in there now, right? We walk in,
really?
And it was like walking into an old Western where the, you know, the piano player stops and everything. Because he has to bend down to come into a room, you know? No door frame fits it, right? And I said to him, I guess, you can't make an easy entrance, can you?
They know me here, boss, don't worry.
Go up to the bar, and the bartender says, hey, Andre, how you doing? The usual? And he's like,
yes, yes, please, boss.
And the usual for Andre was a beer pitcher, right? And I'll never forget that the guy behind the bar took this beer pitcher, empty beer pitcher, and he took every single bottle and filled it with every liquor you can imagine. Vodka, gin, brandy, wine, you name it. And filled it, 40 ounces. And Andre offered me to taste some. And I'd never tasted airplane fuel. I spat out this stuff and coughed, and Andre thought that was very funny. He would be, like that. And he asked me what I wanted to drink, and I said, well, I'll just have a beer. And he goes, So I may be stupid, but I'm not an idiot. I thought I'll just sip a beer very slowly and pace myself, because I knew I was in for a long run. So we chat, we talk about his life, and it's all in the book, about his beautiful life and an incredible life that he's led. And we go to the next bar. And I noticed someone at the second bar who was at the first bar. And I thought, oh, well, that's normal. He's an Andre the Giant. He's bound to have a fan following around, right? And I didn't think anything of it. We go to the third bar. Again, I'm sipping a beer. He's on his 14th. He called him Americans, right? He's on his 14th. If you look, by the way, if you get out your phones, you Google Andre the Giant and beer can, you can get a sense of just how tiny a shot glass the beer can looks in his hand. It's incredible. So this pitcher looked like a tiny glass in his hand. So he would just down it in one. And so we're onto our third bar, and I see this guy again. And I turn to Andre, I go, Andre, I think there's someone following us. And Andre goes, what, where, who, what? And I thought to myself, if this guy really is trouble, he won't be for long. Trying to follow a 7'4", 450-pound guy. Andre looks around and goes, oh, don't worry about it, boss. I go, what, you know him? He goes,
yeah, it's a long story, boss.
I go, Andre, it's 2 a.m. You can tell me. Turns out he'd been to a bar a few years earlier, and as he was stepping out of the bar and waiting for his car, he slipped and fell on a patron who must have thought a building was landing. And this poor guy, I think the suit was settled very quickly and very quietly, but ever since then, NYPD decided to send an undercover cop to follow him. And I'll never forget, Andre turned to me and went,
they said it's for my own safety, boss.
And he turned around and he said,
another drink for him, another.
So he would buy drinks for this guy, and all night long, this guy got free drinks and was cheering. Easiest NYPD job ever. Drinking with Andre. Yeah.
I wanted to just ask, I'm stunned, the book kind of came out of a reunion of the cast, correct?
Right.
So you were all together and that's what inspired you to do this.
Yeah.
It's a unique group of people in your life, is it not?
Yeah.
I mean, and can you talk a little bit about that? And everyone's gone off and done their own thing.
Sure.
And Robin Wright is an ice queen on
House of Cards.
Yeah.
And Mandy on Homeland. Yeah. I know, it's incredible. I mean, look, don't forget, I'm 23 years old when I got cast in this movie, right? I'm a kid, a fairly unknown British actor. So today, I don't think the studio would ever have gone for that. So it was Norman and Rob who really put their faith in me and took an enormous chance by hiring me, because I was fairly unknown at that point. I had done Lady Jane with Helena Bonham Carter, but I really wasn't that well known, you know? And so I was very nervous because I knew all of these actors were. I grew up watching movies. So in the first table read, when I saw Chris Sarandon, I'm like, oh my gosh, it's Leon from Dog Day Afternoon, right there. Nominated for his first performance, brilliant. There's Chris Guest, Nigel Tufnell, Ron Morgan Levin. I was like, that's great. Billy Crystal, I knew him from Soap. I knew him from SNL, you know. And so
I knew all these people's work, and I describe it as a tsunami of talent that I was surrounded by. Yeah, Robin had been on a soap opera. She was doing the soap opera for Santa Barbara.
Yes.
Yeah. Do you remember that?
Oh God. Yeah. I'm older than dirt. Remember?
Well, now they did not want to let her out of her contract, and she auditioned for Bill Goldman, I believe, and Goldman met her, and she read for him, and he called Rob in London and said, you know, I wrote the part, trust me, she's it, we gotta get her. This was a week before we started shooting. We still didn't have about a couple of weeks. And she was the last one cast. And so they had to negotiate Norman Lear and Rob with Santa Barbara to let her out of a contract. I think they added an extra year onto her contract to let her out. So that's how we got her. So we were very lucky, because she's, of course, brilliant, and you know, everybody knows now how great she is. You know. So I was very nervous, I was very insecure, and but everybody made me feel very welcome, and that's all in the book. You know, how sweet they all were to me, and made me feel part of the family, and I can barely remember a day without laughter, as you can tell.
It's a good job.
Yeah.
And to be with all of them again just brought it all back. And
yeah.
Thought, I'm going to write this, and,
yeah.
And we loved it, and we loved the movie. I think we're doing Q&A's. Are we, Eileen, somebody? Are we doing any questions or just signing?
Any more questions? Do you want to, can we do a few Q&A's?
Let's do a few.
Yeah, why not? All right. What's your name?
Nate. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
Which part of Wesley's character do you most identify with?
Ooh, well, I mean, I've never been a swashbuckling hero. So,
the hair is good.
Or a pirate.
My hair is fantastic.
My hair is fantastic.
Oh, my God.
Okay,
he knows.
I identify with hair. No, I don't know. I mean, I didn't really have anything to identify. I guess the only thing I could identify with him was connecting through old films I'd seen as a kid. Like, I'd seen The Adventures of Robin Hood many, many times. It was my stepfather's favorite film, so I'd seen that about 20 times. So, Errol Flynn, I talked to Bill Goldman in the beginning. I asked him what movies he was inspired by, and he gave me a whole list of films, including Sorrow, Adventures of Robin Hood, and The Seahawk, and Crimson Pirate, and so on. So I connected with that level of him by connecting with the films that inspired Goldman to write the part, that particular part. So that's what I really grabbed a hold of. Yeah. Thank you. Yes. Hi. Right there. Yeah, you do it. No, you do it. Yeah.
There.
Okay. Yeah. I've always enjoyed the sword fight with Mandy, and it's one of those scenes where if I'm watching on TV, I know it's coming on, I will drop whatever I'm doing to watch.
Guilty.
But the real big question I have is, what's it like wrestling with Andre the Giant?
Wrestling with Andre. Well, yeah. I mean, when I first met Andre, I didn't know who he was, because I grew up in England, and for some reason, I guess I missed the whole Andre the Giant myth, wrestling myth part. I just missed out on it. So when I asked Goldman and Reiner, when I first met Bill Goldman at the read-through, I said, so have you guys cast Fezzik yet? And Goldman went,
oh boy, have we cast him. We got Andre the Giant.
And I said, Andre the, what? You mean he's like a real giant? He goes,
oh yeah.
And Rob goes, and you get to wrestle him, how great is that? These guys are putting me on. And no sooner had he finished that sentence, the door opened and in walked Andre, you know, as I described, ben, you know, bending down low and came on. I'm going, oh my God. And Goldman describes meeting Andre for the first time. He said, it's like when you go to the Pentagon and people tell you, no matter how big anyone tells you the Pentagon is, you have to be standing in front of it to appreciate the size of the Pentagon. That's what Andre's like. He's like the eighth wonder of the world. You have to be blocked by the sun by him, or shaking his hand and having this hand the size of a pitcher's mitt, making yours feel like an eight-month-old baby's inside of his, to really appreciate it. You know, it's incredible. So wrestling with him. So here's what had to happen. He had terrible back pain, poor Andre. He never complained about it, by the way. But over the years, he shared with me that, combined with carrying this weight, that when he wrestled,
all his opponents really got into like jumping on his back on the canvas, and, like, smashing chairs on his neck and things like that. You know how the wrestling gets out of hand here. And he took quite a punishment, and so he was due to have an operation on his back. He was going to have it before the movie, but the producers persuaded him to wait till afterwards. And, you know, he asked his doctors to give him some pain medication, and they didn't know how much to give him. And what do you give a giant, right? And they said, well, what do you normally take for pain? And he went,
I drink boss.
I think it's the first time a doctor would have, you know, like, prescribed drinking. He said, well, maybe you should just do that. And so, you know, we had the Americans on the set every day, and they never missed a line, never flubbed, never, you know, missed his mark, nothing. He was completely professional. And you'd see him down these things, and you'd go, my gosh, I mean, how is he going to do it? It was just incredible. Anyway, so when it came to me wrestling with him, they built a scaffold around him. So that all the close-ups of me with my arm around his neck, there's no pressure on him at all. I'm literally just standing there with my arms around his neck and with no pressure on his neck. So that's how we shot that. And all the wide shots are with a stunt double who's dressed in some ridiculous large giant suit and a mask, a Fezzik mask. Yeah. So that's how we did that. Yeah.
I did.
So, right. My copy of Princess Bride, first of all, that I got in third grade, was tattered.
Okay.
And then I killed probably about 2 to 3 VHSs. Watching it so much.
Great.
So it's meant so much. But having practiced the sword fight over and over and over, do you think you'd still be able to recreate it? And if so,
yes. Right now. Right here. Absolutely.
Tell them where you just were.
I was just at the
EMP
Museum, where they have a Princess Bride exhibit, and if you go on my Twitter feed, you can see I'm holding the sword for the first time in 27 years. They have the actual sword. Yeah. Yes. So you can go and check it out. It's beautiful. The simple answer is no. You know, I get asked all the time, people say, hey, do you keep up your fencing? I think people have an image of me at home just sort of... my toast. I didn't keep up any of it, so I'm not sure that I could really do it. But if I had to for a film, probably with a little rehearsal, maybe. But yeah, yes.
I'm trying to move around. Yes, right here.
So when you were younger, did you do any acting or were you in a lot of school .
Yes. Good question. What's your name?
I'm Carmen.
Carmen. Good question, Carmen. My first school play was, guess what? Robin Hood. And let me just tell you what a hand this guy was in this. I didn't have the role of Robin Hood. I had a one line. I think I had two lines, actually. I had a walk-on part, and I think I carried some clay pots onto the stage that Robin Hood had just bought in some village, right? And my two lines were, Robin Hood says to me, be careful with those pots, and I go, of course, Your Highness. He says, don't break them, and I go, you, of course I won't. And I trip and I fall and I drop them and they break. And that was it. That was my first time on stage ever. And I delivered the line, I went, of course not, Your Highness, and tripped and fell, and I got a big laugh, and I went, oh. That's kind of cool. And after that, I handed up everything. I remember the director would come up to me and go, too much. Bring it down. Over there. And I every night, it just got bigger and bigger. Crazy. Anyway, yes. That's how I started.
In the back, with the hat.
Hi. What's your name?
Eric.
Hi.
So, for all the guys, how was it kissing Robin?
Robin is great. We became very close friends and still are to this day. So it was very weird kissing her because it was like kissing my best friend. And we ended up doing 6 takes of it and we were just giggling. And Robin was getting very upset. He's like,
cut, cut. What's going on with you? What's going on? Why are you laughing? It's not funny. You're supposed to kiss her here. You want me to try? I'll show you. Robin's like, no, we got it. But yeah, she's great. I love her dearly. She's just a terrific gal and obviously a wonderful talent. And yeah, so six takes, put it more. I don't know which one he used.
Yeah. Way in the
yes,
back.
Yes, Cole. When do we go for Cole?
You go.
Cole. Go ahead, Cole.
So my question is,
why? I love this guy.
Can everybody see him?
Was a real flame in the first was a real flame when in the first line, the first flame came.
Yes, it was. and let me tell Dad right here, don't try this at home. Don't want to play with fire because you will get...
Okay. You're going to leave time. That's a perfect place to end. Thank you, Cole. Thank you, everybody. Your movie has stayed with all of us. It stayed with you, obviously, for your entire career. What a wonderful, proud thing to have. It stayed with all of us. So thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you for coming. Thank you for the work you put forward.